Hi everyone, just doing a sound check. You should be able to hear me as well as see my video. Can someone
Yes,
please
Bharat. Yeah, Bharat, Pranit here. Yeah, we can hear you and we can see your screen.
Okay, so
that's done.
Let's give exactly 3 minutes for everyone else to join. I'll kickstart exactly at 13:30 in next 3 minutes. Thank you.
Hi Bharat, Nisha join.
Okay, I think I'll kickstart now. I hope everyone was able to follow through some of the instructions I had shared here. If you weren't able to, don't worry, I'll run through all the steps in this session. And same as the last week, what you will see is I would have uploaded all the material onto this website. You'll find them same at this page. You'll also find session for the link for the next session. I'll also upload this recording. I'm going to the material. Now this is what is called GitHub. For those who are not familiar with GitHub, and during this entire session, please feel free to stop me, interrupt me if you have any questions, or at any point of time, if you want me to explain something again, please feel free to interrupt me. This GitHub is where, it's a place where all the code is reposited. You can store all your files here. I'll be using this as my primary place where I would keep uploading the material. For this week, I have this README section. I had uploaded some of the ebooks and some documentation on the Jupyter Notebook. So if you have all installed Anaconda, Anaconda is a software which comes with its own Python and Jupyter Notebooks already installed. Along with this, it also installs for you all the libraries that you would require mostly for this course. So it's widely used by the scientific community and the data community. That's why Anaconda was my preferred way of going about this course. So if you would have installed, this is how it would come. So you would have an Anaconda navigator, which is how, this is how it launches. And you would have certain other things already installed for you. So I'll quickly give a brief overview of what this Anaconda is, what do you do with these interfaces, and then move to launching a Jupyter Notebook and then starting with the operations on this Jupyter Notebook. So this is how your Anaconda browser would look like. Now, some of you might not have all the things that you are seeing here. That's purely because I would have installed some of the things which you don't have as of now. But at the minimum, what you would see is a spider. This is a development environment. So same like Jupyter Notebook. So first half of the course, when we want things to be interactive, when we want things, when we are doing quite a lot of experimentation, we're going to use Jupyter Notebooks. So you should also have Jupyter Notebooks. This is raw core Python. So this just opens a empty shell. This would be the Python shell. It looks like this. So this is how Python at the core would look like. So I can do operations like this, 2 plus 2, and it should be able to calculate 4 for me.
Sorry, Bharat, Pranit here. I'm sorry. Actually, I can see your screen, but it is not visible. I'm not sure if some other participants are getting the same. Just please.
I think the screen is not moving. I think screen is not moving.
Yep. Can you please zoom your desktop a little bit?
Are you able to see this Anaconda Navigator with a white background?
No.
I can see that.
Yes.
Suresh here, I can see that. Screen is moving also.
Yes, Bharat, I can also see everything. Tarun here.
But not that. That's what. Like I can see everything, but not the typings and not the screen.
Oh, that's fine. That's fine. It was not. I was just showing how IPython looks like. I will not be using it in the course anytime because imagine that as a Python background. The foreground, you will use a graphical user interface. This installation comes with two interfaces, Spider and Jupyter Notebook. So you should be able to see at least these three things in your Anaconda installation. What I would suggest is never to launch it like this. This gives you very less controls. Later, as we progress through our course, I'll explain how to configure this as your central command. But for now, I just wanted to show you this. This is not what you would use though. So I'm closing this. What you would also see is if you type Anaconda, you will have this Anaconda Navigator, Spider, and you will also see Anaconda Prompt. So this is what I want you guys to start using. So click this. It should open up a console like this. It would look like a DOS console. However, it is not MS-DOS. It is Anaconda Prompt. You can differentiate from usual command prompt because you can see something called a base between two brackets here, and it also reads Anaconda prompt. Now this is from where I want you to start your operations, purely for the reason that I want all of you to start getting comfortable with command line. Anything that can be done in command line can be automated, as you will see very soon. So in here, wherever you want to start your projects from. So let's say for me, I have this file. In my F drive, I have ML Bootcamp. And in this, I've created a folder, session one. Okay, I'll delete everything here to start from scratch. So my session one is empty. From my terminal, I would navigate to that. How I would navigate? CD dot dot would take me one step previous. So imagine it as clicking the up icon on your folder. However, I want to navigate to my F drive. I would directly type F drive. I would change my directory to wherever I want to browse to. So CD ML Bootcamp. Now this can be anything on your computer. I'm just going to a folder where I would save everything, and that's where I would ideally want my Jupyter Notebook launched. Jupyter Notebook is not like any other app. It would have to be launched from a place to which you want it to be accessible to. So if your files are saved in a folder, you want your Jupyter Notebook to access those files, you need to launch Jupyter Notebook from somewhere in those folders only. So for that reason, I'm browsing till this place. So ML Bootcamp CD session 1. Once I'm at a folder from where I want to launch my Jupyter Notebook, I will simply type Jupyter Notebook. Now remember, you have to do this not on your command prompt. You have to do it in Anaconda prompt. So this should give some details like this. At the background, what is happening is it is loading some extensions. It is creating a server within your PC. And that server is served up here. If you see localhost 888, localhost means the server is hosted right on your own computer. 888 means this is the port that the server is using to display and receive and send data. Now it has opened up this folder for me. As you see, I don't have anything here. I don't have anything here as well. If I create something here, a blank text document, if I refresh, you can refresh from here, you can see those here. From here, you can launch Jupyter Notebook. So this is just the server interface of Jupyter Notebook. From here, you can start using Jupyter Notebook. So what I need you to do is click on this new button here. In the dropdown, it will identify your existing Python installation. So for me, I have Python 3. I would click here, Python 3, and it should launch a notebook in a new tab for me. Now this is a brand new notebook. This is how Jupyter Notebooks would look like. All of these commands would be my inputs and it would give me output right here. It would be very interactive. So that's the reason why I want you guys to start using Jupyter Notebooks. Now you would see I have already given some PDF ebooks. So download them, go through them, but at least spend some time reading the first 4 chapters of the first book, this book. So read through first 4 chapters. It would give you fairly good understanding of what I would cover today. And it will also set you up for the next session. I've also saved a Jupyter Notebook. Now, when you click on it, it should come up like this. You should be able to read, but what you would see is you're not able to interact or type anything. That's because it's open on GitHub. It's not open in your Jupyter Notebook. How do you download it? Any Jupyter Notebook that I upload on GitHub, click on raw. It should give you something like this. Just right click, save as, and save it to wherever you want to save. Remember one thing, when I save it like this, it's reading text document. So it would save as a text document, not as a Jupyter Notebook. So always change it to all files. I'll show you what happens when you don't change and how to catch this. So I haven't changed anything. Let's do it again. So I've just saved as and clicked here. I go to my Jupyter Notebooks. I refresh this. I can see this, but see, you have a .txt here, something which Windows hides usually. So though I can see IPJNYB, this is IPython Jupyter Notebook, but here it comes with .txt. If I open, it doesn't make any sense. So ideally this would not be the right way of doing things. What I would want you to do is, right click, save as, and change this to all files, and then save it. I've overwritten the previous file. Now when I refresh, it should come up here. Save as, all files. I'll call it something else. Let's call it notebook 1. Now you see notebook 1 comes here. Now it doesn't come with a .txt. If I click here, it should open up Jupyter Notebook exactly in its native format. Now it's readable and usable. You can start interacting with it. See, now it's clickable. You can click it. You can interact with it. You can edit it. You can write whatever you want. So that's Jupyter Notebook, how to launch it. At this point, just I'll take a 2-minute break. I'll ask if anyone has any question until this step. No? Okay. So I'm going to start. How do I see chat, guys?
Bharat?
Yes.
Hi, Nisha here. Actually, I'll tell you this. GitHub was new to me, and I traversed to what you had given, but I was unable to install Anaconda.
So where did you get stuck? You would have gone to which system do you use? It's a Windows system?
10, yeah.
Windows system. So, okay. Yeah. I am just Googling for Anaconda. The first site that comes up. Anaconda, the world's okay. most popular data science. I would click this. And in here, let's see. Here, I've just gone to products. Individual edition, or it's okay. much more simpler. Anaconda download Windows. And you have quite a lot of tutorials also, videos, tutorials on how to download Anaconda. Mm-hmm. So I've just typed Anaconda download mm-hmm. Windows, and any of these are just 2-3 minute videos. It should be able to help you. So okay. Anaconda itself was also mm-hmm. very nice documentation on how to install, and it has all links. Mm-hmm. So installing on Windows Anaconda documentation download, it takes me back to the same
thing. You know, I will say my bad, you know. I thought of doing this, but I was, you know, looking for link in your documentation. So my bad. I thought in a specific version I need to download, that is why.
No, you can download any version you want. Just ensure that for Windows you download the Windows part. 99% it detects the right version, but for some mm-hmm. people, if you are running very specific instances of Ubuntu Linux, that's when you will have to configure a few things. It's all very well documented, actually.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. That's the Anaconda bit. So I'm going to simultaneously start a new notebook and then recreate everything that... Is there any way I can make this disappear?
Hi, Bharat. One thing. Yeah. Can you just show how to open this Jupyter notebook from the Anaconda prompt?
Okay. So I'm closing all the notebooks. So because I'm all here, I'll tell you what to do when you close your notebook. So just like a browser, just exit. It auto saves, but it's good practice to save it. After you exit, when you are here, this is your original place where you launch notebooks from. You will see certain things in green. You will have certain tabs. Go to running tab and always shut down whatever is running. That way you're sure that it's a clean exit. And then click quit. Don't directly click here because it would just close the browser. Your server would keep running. So click quit. And then it should give you a message like this that it's safe to shut it down. Then you can exit. Here it should come out of this. See, it reads it has shut down everything. So I'll start from beginning just so that everyone of you can follow. From your start menu, open Anaconda prompt. On your Anaconda prompt, navigate to the folder where you want to start your project. So mine is F ML Bootcamp. Session one, and wherever, whenever you are in that folder, from there type Jupyter Notebook, J U P Y T E R. It's not Jupyter, it's not J U P I, it's J U P Y T E R Notebook. As soon as you click enter, it should open up in your default browser. And it should show you contents of that folder as well. So I am in this folder, F Bootcamp session one. I have these files, same files I can see here. If I already have a Jupyter notebook, I can directly click and open it. Or if I want to launch like this one, or if I want to start a new one, I'll click new and Python 3. It would start a new notebook for me. Was that clear?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. So, first thing, Jupyter Notebook has these things. These are called cells. Cells is where all the computation happens. So, everything in this notebook would be series of cells. In these cells, you can put a text as well. But by default, these act as your coding place where you enter your codes. So if you have to convert something to a text, like this is my first notebook, I have to press escape and M and this front part disappears. And if I press enter, it will take me add a new line. But if I want to execute this cell, I press shift enter and this gets executed as a text. As long as you have this in front of the notebook, that means it's assuming whatever you type is a code and not a text. So if I press 2 plus 2 and press enter, it adds a new line. However, if I press shift enter, it would have executed a code. So in Python, everything that you input comes with this tag IN, and everything that console output, it gives as a tag with OUT, out. The numbers you see here is the execution order. This was the first command which I entered, so it comes one. If I type anything else, let's say 5 into 89 and press shift plus enter, not enter, shift plus enter. Because it was the second command I executed, it was second. Let's say I type something here, 10 minus 9, it's third. I go back to this cell and now edit it. You see, this was the fourth command executed. So it overrode and it became fourth. So this is a way where you can quickly figure out what cells were run in and watch in which order. So for now, just remember these are inputs. And if you have to convert an input into a text, you have to press escape and press M. Or you can go to cell. So same way. Instead of shift enter, you can just say run cells, and to change it to text, cell, cell type, markdown. Markdown. Markdown means it's a now cell which takes text as input. And if I type something like 2 plus 2 and hit shift enter, it's just going to be displayed as text. If I go back, click here, and you can know that it's not a input cell, it's a text cell when you don't see anything here. I can go back to cell, cell type, and change it to code. Now it comes back. Now I press, when I press shift enter, it starts acting as a code. So this is how your Jupyter notebook works. You can directly see the output to every input. Your program need not run fully. You can run your program line by line or sequentially while seeing the output. So it allows quite a lot of interactivity in it. So as in with any typical computer programming, the first thing that you learn is to print hello world. So printing anything in Jupyter notebook is very simple. Just type print. And if you want to print a text, enclose it in single quotations or double quotations. whatever I type here, it would print. I've used double quotes or a single quote. It doesn't matter. But it has to be enclosed within quotes. Now, with this knowledge, let's start with variables. Variables are things.
Just a quick question, Sanjeev here.
Yes,
so, do we have any limitation with the tab or space when we are writing in the code? Something like, so in the SQL and all that, we have this limitation, no?
So if I do this,
okay,
it will still work. Python is very, very flexible in understanding. However, when you start learning loops, for loop, while loop, where structure inherently matters, you will see that indentation matters. So Python is an indented language. In languages like C, where you enter a statement with a colon, you would not require anything to end a statement. You just press shift enter and it executes. But spacing does matter in some scenarios. We'll cover when in the next session when I'm covering for loops and while loops on when the spacing exactly matters. But for a single command, spacing does not matter. When you have multiple commands put together and each of one is really independent, then these of this matter. So see, now it says unexpected indent. So if you're running just one simple line, it doesn't matter. If you're, it matters when you're running multiple lines together. That's when the spacing would really matter.
Bharat, can you just attempt to enter something very random? I just want to see, like, you know, what system would throw.
Like this?
Yes.
It would just repeat it. So name, this is not defined. Well, when I said everything has to be enclosed within either a single quote or a double quote, that's when Python recognizes it as a text. Now, it's identifying this as some variable, as some object, and that's why it says name, this is not defined. However, if I was to enclose it within quotations and type any random thing and press enter, because it's a text, it will just appear like that.
Bharat, are we going to cover, like, the, are there any reserve words, like, you know, for the syntax for Python?
Yes, there are quite a lot of reserve words, but mostly I would advise never to go in a way where you are memorizing reserve words.
Yeah.
So while it is good to have that, so when you read through those first four chapters in the ebook which I've given, it would give you a list of those reserve words, but generally when you are assigning a variable, tend to assign a variable which is meaningful and not something which is like, while Python would allow you to use a reserve word for storing any number or whatever variable you want to choose, but it might conflict later in the program. So it's very, if you stick to some few principles like naming your variables in a meaningful way to that variable, you would never encounter that problem. And even if you use reserve words as variables, most likely Python would accept it and work fine, only in very specific cases where it might collide with the reserve words. But yeah, as and when we use our variables more, I'll come to those.
Yep. Bharat, like, you know, before we start deep diving into the concepts of Python, can you just, like, spend a couple of minutes on, this is my first session. Sorry, apologies for that. The reason I'm asking this. Second is, since, like, you know, everyone comes from a different background, like, can you just emphasize on, like, you know, what is the significance of this language and where actually do we use it?
Oh, well, that would take me to quite a lot in a very different tangent. So that would be, perhaps I can keep it reserved for question answer session in later half an hour.
We can take that. Yeah, please go ahead.
So I'll take that in later half an hour. So please do remind me. I'll attempt to answer that as a first question in last half an hour. Is that fine, sir?
Yeah. Please go ahead. Yeah. I don't want to disturb the class. Okay.
So Python language is is designed to read with emphasis that it's very readable. So it's 99% English. It's very simple and it's very explicit in how it looks like. So even if you read a program, you should be able to understand what it is. One more thing to understand is in Python, you have something called commenting. So anything that you type after a hash symbol is ignored. So whatever you type, 2+2, it's ignored. My name is Bharat. It's ignored. So why it is used is when you're writing your own program and you want to add comments so that you know what is happening in the program, because you would see it very often when you start coding that you would require placeholders where it allows you sort of very high level documentation for you to understand what your program, what your code is doing. So that's where this is used. Also, when you code and you want to quickly ignore some part of the code and execute rest of the code, that's when you would put hash in front of that. So far we have covered what are these cells, difference between text and numerical operations, and what does this hash do. You can space out anything after hash. So anything that starts with a hash, regardless how far ahead it is just ignored. It can be anything. So just remember that a hash would ignore that particular line of code. Next I wanted to talk about was variables. So you can assign values to things and do operations on those things. So you want to assign a value of 4. The variable would come on left side, the value would come on the right side. So that's how Python would work. Equal to is an assignment operation. So what I'm doing here is assigning the value of 4 and storing it in a variable called x. So now if I type x, it would give me what is stored in x. You can also do printx. Now you see, I have not enclosed it within these quotes. So if I put quotes around this, Python would interpret that I'm trying to type a text called x. But this is not what I want. I want the value inside x. So now I just type x. X is a variable. Python would know that value of x is 4 and it should ideally print 4. Now what I'm going to discuss next is what are the types of these values that you can store in variable. So you have already seen a number which is stored. Now with this you can do operations. So if I wanted to do this 2+2, I can instead do x+2 and it gives me 6. I can store this x+2 in another variable y and then see what y is. So this is simple variable assignment. What variables can do? You can store text also in a variable. So, but as I said, text should be enclosed within double quotes or single quote. This assigns value of Bharat to x. So when I print x, it comes like this. Now in print statement, I said you can type whatever you want. What if you wanted part of something fixed and then the variable? So print, this is first session by. I would just put a comma and put the variable which I want to type. So the static text would be enclosed by these colons followed by the variable, and then it gives me this session is first. This session is first session by. This is first session by. And then whatever is in the variable. Now this, what it includes the spaces also. In with whatever comes within the colons would get copied exactly like that, including the spaces.
Okay. Why comma in between, Bharat?
Yeah.
There was a comma before the x.
Yes. So the way you have to type is print your colons, whatever text you want to appear, and then comma, and whatever variable you want to. So let's say I want a variable y and then variable x, because we had defined both. These have to be segregated. Now I'm passing three things to be printed. First thing is a text, static text, comma, second variable, comma, third variable. If I want to add more text, comma. So whatever has to be passed has to be segregated with commas.
Okay.
So when I, whatever text, this part came here, my y variable had 6 stored in it. So y, 6 came in the same order. Then came x, which was Bharat. And then came this text.
Okay.
So regardless number of things you put in print, separate them with commas.
Thank you.
Bharat, yeah. I have just question. So you have defined the variable x twice actually in the entire thing. So first you define the variable x as 4, I believe, and then the same variable x is Bharat. So if I want to execute 4 only, so how do I execute 4? Do I need to define it again as a 4?
So how variables and storage works in Python is, I'll show you quickly. So we have a variable x and I assign 4 to it. Now when I say print x, it is 4. Let's say I define a variable y, which I assign to x. Print y. Now I change x to 6. What should this do? Print x. It gives me 6. Now this is a question for you. If I print y, what would it give?
It will give 4 only.
4?
It would give...
So Bharat, the simplistic answer is basically every variable is pointing towards one object. If we change the variable, it will start pointing to a different object, right? It won't point to the same object which we have defined earlier.
That's the perfect answer. So every variable, imagine x or whatever variable pointing to the number. So here, first thing we did was x was pointing to 4. Okay. So every time I call x, it would, because it's pointing inside Python, it's pointing to 4, it will pull up 4. Now, when I put y is equal to x, y points to 4. So that's why these two would be two different objects pointing to same value. Now when I changed x to 6, this x started pointing to 6, but y is still pointing to 4. So that's why y stays at 4 and x changes. So every time you assign a variable, it would point to the latest value which you would have given. This works when in direct assignment. However, when I start, like in next couple of minutes, I'll show you different data types. For some data types, this concept changes. So you have seen text being assigned and a number being assigned. Now this number can be anything. It can be a pure number. It can be a decimal number. So in Python, these are called integers and floats. This is called a text string. How do you find what is stored in a variable? There are two ways actually I wanted to share with you. I'm not able to see the tabs because this thing keeps popping up. See, so. Okay, first way is something called isInstance. You can query what is x. So this thing is called isInstance. So isInstance x a string, it says false. If I say isInstance x an integer, true. If I change x to something called 3, 2 point something, now it has become a float. decimal numbers are called floats in Python or most of the programming languages. So is instance x integer, it gives me false now. Is instance x float. So wherever you type something wrong, Python is extremely good at telling you what is wrong. So here it says name error, name. This not defined. Instead of is, I typed in instance by mistake. So x is float. This is how you can figure out what type of object is stored. There is one particular other way. Type. So x is float. Y is 4. So if I type, it shows int. So you can use either an interrogation method or directly take out what type it is. Both have different uses. So imagine when programming, you have to take a decision based on whether it's an integer or not. You would prefer this. Or if you just want to know what type it is, you can use this. So both of these methods are important. Is instance and type. The notebook I have saved in the GitHub. I've also showed you how to take that. You would see is there any way I can get rid of this bar? Okay, so in this notebook, you can see both these instances defined. So once you go through it, you will understand all of these better. Every variable has some attributes to it. Also, so when you start working, there are certain shortcuts in this Jupyter notebook. So when I set type type y, it should give me type. So halfway through, if I press tab on my keyboard, it would autofill. So I'm not typing anything. See, T, I press tab, it will give me every possibility that is there within Jupyter notebooks. So as I type more, it will filter out exactly what I'm typing. So press tab and use down key, up key to arrive at whatever you want. These are some of the quick shortcuts that you'll find very useful.
Bharat, one quick question. Maybe in the later next session you are going to cover, but if let's say I saw like you are changing these variables x equals to 2.5, then you have changed to 4 or something like that. If let's say I want to fix that, nobody can touch, nobody can change this. Is there any command or something like
that? Yeah, so you have to keep a track of your variables. When you start coding, once you touch x, there are ways to determine that x stays immutable. So that, because now I've defined a variable, x is a variable. Variable means it can change.
Yes.
I will touch base some of the data structures which are immutable. So these will not change regardless. So these would be when you don't want anything to change within the runtime of a program. I will touch base on those data types as well.
Okay.
So if I press y dot, now y has, so y is an object. Everything in Python is an object. So this variable x, this variable y are objects. So let's say x is a string. As of now, I put it as a string and y is a number. X, because everything in Python is an object, it would have certain methods available. You can do some of the things to an object. But what you can do to an object depends on what type of object it is. So here x is a text object, y is a number, numerical object. So if I press x dot and press tab, it will give me all the methods associated to that object. What can I do? So because x was text, immediately it says capitalize. So let's try what that is. So what it does is, you see, I started with a small b. Now it has capitalized that b. Y dot, and I'm pressing tab on my keyboard. Now you see these things change. So the methods, and these things are called methods. These are things you can do to an object. So because my object has changed, now this is an integer object, the methods I can use are different. So you will continuously, as you learn more, you will start using these more and more. So it's, as I said, it's just like learning any other language. A lot of it would be very new, very difficult. And in your head, it won't piece together in a linear fashion, because language inherently is like that, unstructured. You wouldn't learn what is a noun, pronoun, and then start learning words. Ideally, you start learning words and then you understand the structure of the language, and then you can form coherent sentences. It's like that. So there will be a lot of things which are disjointed, unconnected. Don't worry about it. Just go with the flow, start reading, start practicing these small, small things. And sooner or later, perhaps in next couple of sessions, you'll realize that you start understanding the structure of it. That's when it all starts making sense. So keep practicing. Don't worry if these things don't make sense or these things don't connect together too well. Okay, so this was our understanding of Jupyter Notebook, variables, and what are the things that we can add to these variables. Now I want to talk about data structures. What type of object? So first object was this text type of object, number type of object. There are something called data types in Python. Data types broadly determine what are the various type of objects that you can put in Python. And different Python, different objects would have
different... May I interrupt you in between? Like, are the questions for the end, or is there something related to it?
No. Please interrupt me anytime you want me to stop me or you have any question.
Thank you, Bharat. So Bharat, I just wanted to know that, for example, we had this Jupyter Notebook and we executed multiple snippets in here, but normally, if it were a program that I was writing in Python, would all these lines be considered part of one program?
Yes, you can run all the cells. So you see run here. If I click run, everything would execute. The entire code would execute. You can move these up and down. So kernel is when you can stop this Python session and restart. So let's say if I restart and clear all the output, it should ideally, so see, now it is just code and there is no output. And you see all of this has disappeared, the execution. So I can run all the cells, run one cell. I can select a cell and say run cells only above the one, only below the one, or run all. If I click run all, you see everything has run just like a program, 1, 2, 3. And the beauty of it is, every line, as and when it executes, it will give you an output. So it becomes a very, very easy. It becomes very easy to understand what is happening inside a program. Some of the cells don't have an output because these are either commented out, or in here there is nothing to output. I just assigned 4 to x. There is nothing else. But when I print x, that's when the output comes. Here, I've just assigned this text to x. Nothing comes out. There is nothing to print. However, execution of this cell means X now points to an object, which is a text called Bharat. And when I print it, the output comes. So it works just like program, where you, during your stage of program building, you would want this functionality where you want to see in every line what is happening. But later when you deploy programs in production, you would not be interested in any of these. That's when you will move to what I showed you, Spider. In later part of our program, we'll move to Spider when we are not interested in all of these. Okay, does that answer your question?
Yes, it does. And one more thing, like Bharat, here initially you define x is equal to 4, and then you assigned it the value of Bharat. So the variable does not have an associated type with it.
Exactly, you are right. Python is so it's called a hard typing, soft typing. Python is not similar to C or Java, where you have to define a type of X. So Python is extremely fluid that X is just an object and what stores. So this is called Python ducking type. Why it is called a ducking type is if it walks like a duck, it looks like a duck, it is a duck. So if X has something in it which looks like a text, behaves like a text, it is a text type. So X can change depending on the context of it. If I say Bharat in it, X becomes a string. If I change X to 3.4, it becomes a float. If I store an integer, it becomes an integer. So X would change depending on what is stored inside it. So in X is just an object pointing to another object. Now, what is the type of X would totally depend on what is the nature of the object. And that's how Python becomes so much more flexible, where as a programmer, you don't have to worry about any of these things. Python takes care of all of it at the back end.
Thank you.
So now, as I said, Python, everything is an object pointing to some other object. Now it is, there are certain structures to these objects. So like this is a text. Now we can have some other things. Like if I want something to be a continuous series of numbers and I want something to point to that, that would be called list. So our first data type. So let's start with string because you're familiar with this. So X is equal to my first class. Now, if I check type, it's a string. It's one huge string. Now, I want to do certain operations on this data. Let's say I want to figure out, let's start with identifying how can I segregate my data if I want to just read some parts of it. First thing is, when you type length, L-E-N, it will give you how long this is. It would also give you, it will count within it all the spaces heads also. You can slice it as well. So X. Now slicing is an operation where you are imagine cutting this into multiple pieces. So I want to cut out this piece and then pick up the piece of only my interest. The syntax for this is whatever object is there, put that object, start with a square bracket and then start colon stop. This is the syntax. Where do you want to start? Where do you want to stop? So let's say I want to start with 1, 2, space is also a letter. So space is also a character, not letter. Space is also a character in Python. So 1, 2, 3. I want to start with F. So ideally it should be 1, 2, 3, 4. So let's say I want to start with 4, colon. Where do I want to stop? 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Now with this, yeah, our output is going to differ a little from what I wanted it to be. And via it, let's try to understand what Python is actually doing. So first thing you would notice is, I wanted it to capture this part. However, it just captured this part. So let's break this down on what's happening. I wanted to start at 4. My theory was 1, 2, space, third, and F becomes 4. But here R is 4. That's because in Python, everything starts with a 0. All the indexing, everything starts with a 0. So M becomes 0th index, Y becomes first index, space becomes second index, F becomes third index. Now let's try writing this again and then change it to 3 and see if that is what we wanted. This comes. So, but now you might ask, if this is 0, this also should have shifted. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, T7. But here I have put 8. Why is space not getting captured? If I put 7, T disappears. That means this syntax would mean start from third element, third index. In Python, indexes start from 0. So this starts from third index, goes all the way till 7, excluding 7th. So when I put 8, it starts from third index and continues till 8th index, excludes 8. This is how everything in Python work. All the other data types also would follow same principles. Everything is indexed at 0. It starts with an index and ends with an index, excluding that very index. Okay. So I can slice, let's say I want first 5 letters. So I can start with x0 and put 5 to exclude 5, or put 6 to include 5th character. Now shortcut is, usually when we want to start from beginning, we can leave it blank. It will still pull up. We can, similar way, if I know that I want to start from 10th character and go all the way till end, I can remove my stop character. So if it starts from 10th index and goes all the way till the end. If I leave both blank, it will start all the way from front and go all the way till the end. It will pull up everything. So these are basic slicing operations. I've started with string because it would have been easy conceptually, but same is applicable, as I will show, for every other data class. So with that, data classes. One other thing I wanted to show was, you can add a skip character. So X, you want it from second all the way till last, and you want every alternate one. So you can put another colon, and whatever number you type here is the skipping order. So if I put 2, it will, so I want something to start all the way from the beginning because I've left it empty. Ending is also empty. So I want it to go all the way till the end, but I want only every second character. So if you see M, first one, second one is skipped. Third one was an empty character. It put blank there. F, fourth one skipped. R, fifth one picked up. If I change this to 3, it will pick up every third character. There is a space here, space, F, R, remove. So it starts from the first character M, then ignore the second, third, and then picked up the fourth. So every third character from the first one. So that's a quick way to skip characters if I want every alternate one, every third one, or every nth item of any object. This is how you do it. So while we have discussed it with for string object, you can do the same operations for any object. If there are multiple objects assigned to a variable, you now know how to sort these objects from the start, from the end, how to pick up nth object of anything. So I think this sets up nicely for how to assign multiple things to some variable, let's say. So there is inherent structure, multiple structures. I want to start with list. So list is any set of numbers which have some order in it. List is always enclosed in brackets. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I've assigned 8 numbers to something called an X, enclosed within brackets. So it becomes a list. If I select type X, now you will see it's as a list. Now same here, it was a text object, it's a list object. However, this would remain same. So if I wanted to take only fifth object, I can type 4 and it has picked up fourth object. It starts from 0, 1, 2, 3. So here is one small difference. So index starts from 0, but I've picked up fourth element of here. fourth element of X. I'm not indexing. I picked up fourth element of X. So first, second, third, fourth. If I want to pick up starting from second to fifth, now I have put index to it because there is a colon here. If I want to pick up every alternate element like I showed before, same way. I want it from start to end, but I want every second element. So it picks up one, skips two, three, skips four, five, skips seven. So operations remain change. It's just that these all would be still relevant to whatever object is of our choice. This object is list. You don't have to worry if it is quite a lot. You don't have to worry if you're thinking that you won't be able to remember all of these. No one is supposed to remember any of these. These will become your second nature as and when we start working. So if you're worried that this is too much, and one main thing, you don't have to take notes at all. You will do it so many times and so frequently and so intuitively from our next session that it will all become your second nature. I just wanted you to be familiar in these sessions with some of the terminology I'm going to use. That's why I'm showing you all of these. Okay, I've covered this. I've covered list. Okay, so let's check some of the now. So earlier it was number, text. Now it's a list. List object also has some methods available to it. So I press X dot and press tab. Now you have quite a lot of other things. Pop, remove. Now everything is very well documented. You can read, or as and when we work, I can cover these. Just to show you an example, list dot append. Now, as soon as I open a bracket and press shift tab, it should give me a hint on what this is. So shift tab, only tab for autocomplete, shift tab to bring up help on any object. So it says append object to the end of list. Okay, let's see what it does do. So let's first see what our print is. Now I want X dot, I tab it, enter, open a shift tab. I want to read through it. It says append an object to the end of list. Let's append 0 and see what happens. You see, it has added a 0 to it. Now all of these are numbers. Let's see if we can add a character to it. Or because it's a character, it has to be enclosed by these commas. You see, list is just a collection of objects regardless of the type of objects. So unlike many other languages, Python allows you to mix these objects as well. So all it means is list is a collection of objects. Python doesn't really care what type of objects these are. These can be characters, these can be numbers as well, these can be float as well. So it has added all these three.
And the list can be multidimensional too?
Yes, list can be multidimensional too. So usually multi-dimensional lists are called data frames. So I'll come to that. Imagine a multi-dimensional list as your Excel is a two-dimensional list. Same way you can have a three-dimensional, four-dimensional. Machine learning would always use multi-dimensional lists or multi-dimensional arrays to be more specific. There are certain very subtle differences. What is the difference between list and array? I would cover them when we reach there. But yes, to answer to your question, yes, lists can have any number of dimensions. So Bharat, list, yeah.
One small question. So I have seen that whenever you are calling a function like type or len, you are using the brackets. Whenever you are indexing and slicing, you are using the other some other type of brackets. When we would be discussing loops construction and all that, you would be using curly brackets. So how to remember all these things? Is there any logic when to use the square brackets and the curly brackets and like so and so forth, basically?
Right. So for any function like a len, function would always have these type of brackets, these smooth brackets, whatever these brackets are called, the yep. normal brackets. For any method that I am using, x, let's say I'm doing some operation directly on x, I would use these square brackets. Now, this depends on the type of object. So list has these, as you would say, dictionary would have something like this. But you, as I said, you don't need to remember this. You will do it so often that it will become second nature to you. Soon you'll realize that you don't even need to think about these things. It will come to you. Don't worry about that. So there are multiple. One thing to remember is for function, it's definitely this. And these are what am I doing to X are usually some sort of methods. Like append methods are also with a normal bracket. But if I want to slice X, I use directly square brackets. That's the difference. We can also assign other variables within this list. So let's say Z was Bharat. X dot append, because it's a method, I'm using normal brackets. Now if I say print, because print is a function, I would use normal brackets. You see, it has taken even a variable inside it. So list is just a collection of objects. These objects can be of whatever type you want. Same way as with strings, you know now how to slice, dice, and pick up the objects which you want to pick up from a list. So that's in brief everything there is about a list. There are certain other methods, like x.clear would totally remove, would clear out the list. So if I now print x, it's blank. It's a blank list though. It has cleared out everything from it. So I'm going to assign few more things to X just to show you some more operations. So I've put some more objects. So X.copy would copy this to something else. So what do I want to copy it to? Let's say Y. Now question is, what is difference between this two? So let's say Y is equal to X dot copy, Z is equal to X, print Z. Both are printing same thing, but there is a difference. Y points to same object as X points to. So if you change that object, Y will point to the changed object. Y will not point to the same object, because Y is pointing to a copy of that object, but Z would change. Let's see. So you got Y is pointing to a copy of X, but Z is directly pointing to whatever X is pointing to. So here, if I put AX dot append and I add something to it, now my X looks like this. Z was pointing to same thing as X was pointing to, and I've changed that directly. So Z also changes. However, Y would not change, because Y is pointing to a copy of X. So these are some of the ways where which you will encounter very frequently to keep your program clean and from having undesired changes. One other, so how do you append would always add some element at the end of it. How do you remove things off? So x dot pop would take off the last element and give it to you. So if I put z is equal to x dot pop, now z would have the last element and x would be less the last element. So I took off Bharat here, then x was only this. Now I popped 6 also off, now x is only this. This is how you take off x. You can add, delete, insert, remove exactly in the same way. This gives you a little more control. So let's say x dot index. I want to add Bharat. I want to add Bharat at first location. Bharat is added at first location. So you can change this to whatever number you want and it will come exactly at that place. Because I executed it twice, it came twice. So you now know how to add, delete, take things from the list. Again, I would keep saying this. No need to worry about memorizing anything. No need to worry about thinking that you need to know all this to progress further. This is only to get comfortable to a stage where you understand these things.
Hello, Bharat. I have a question.
Sure.
So just now you said that for any list, right? There was a list called X. It has certain numbers and text. Then you assigned it to Y, a copy of it to Y, and then also assigned X to Z directly, right? So now when we see the Y is copy, so even if you append, insert, or any changes done in X would reflect with Z because it directly points to X, but it won't impact anything on Y because it was just a copy of the first X created, right? That's how it was working.
Correct.
Earlier, when you were showing variable, you showed us that x is equal to 4, y is equal to x, and then x is equal to 6. At that time, y was not changing. However, y was changing, right?
Think of it as what is something pointing to. Mm-hmm. So, x is pointing to 4.
Yeah.
Y is now pointing to
mm-hmm. X.
Whatever x is pointing at.
Okay.
So mm-hmm. there is something in memory, there is a number called 4.
Mm-hmm.
Here x is pointing there, y is also pointing. So y is pointing to a place, mm-hmm. y is pointing to x is pointing to 4.
Okay.
Let's try changing 6. X is 6, y is 4. Because, yep. So, X was pointing to a memory location which had a number 4. Okay, till mm-hmm. there you are clear.
Mm-hmm.
Y is also pointing to a memory location which has a number 4. That's what we did here.
Okay.
Now what you're doing here is you're not changing anything in the memory. You're adding 6 to another part of memory, and now X instead of pointing to 4 is pointing to that location in the memory.
Okay.
So Y still keeps pointing at X. Y still keeps pointing at the memory location which had number 4 in it, and that's why you didn't see the number change. Y is still 4, but X has pointed to something else now. Now, in a list, let's say this is a list. Y is equal to X. There is a memory. In memory is this list stored. X is pointing to that memory. Mm-hmm. Y is also pointing to this memory. Now, when I change X, something curious happens. Y has changed. Because X is pointing to an object in memory. That object was this. I've changed the object here directly. I have not told X to point to somewhere else. I've changed the object directly. And that's why you would see Y is still pointing to that object. Now, Y is this. Now I have asked X to be pointed to this text, but Y keeps pointing to this object. Now you are clear?
Yep, makes sense. So if my understanding is correct, in simple words, basically when we create a variable, it points to an object, obviously. But when we create a list, the object is changed. However, whenever it picks the Y, it says the object is just appended. It's not changed or anything. So it changes accordingly. That's what I am understanding. So between the list and the variable.
In this way. Let me draw it for you. So this is your RAM.
Yeah.
This is an object which you have created. It has a value 4.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when you say X is equal to 4, what you are saying is this X points to a memory location which has the value 4 stored in it. When you say Y is equal to X, you are creating another object Y. Oh, everything in Python is an object.
Mm-hmm.
So you are creating another object Y. It is pointing to a same location as X is pointing.
Mm-hmm.
Now when you do 5 is equal to X, you have created something called 5, stored it in memory. Now X points to this 5. But what happened to Y? Y kept pointing to this. That's why if you put Y is equal to print Y, it will still keep showing 4. Now when it comes to list, in list, what happens is, so this is your RAM. Now you have assigned a list to a portion of RAM. Now this can be 0, 1, 2, B, X. You create an object X, it points here. Now when you say X is equal to Y, you create an object. Now, when you say X dot append, what is happening? Are you creating any new object? No.
No.
What you're doing is you're extending this and adding something here. Now, what happens to Y? Y continues pointing here. That's why when you click Y, print Y, it will show you this new object because you have not created a new object. You have changed the existing object. I hope this makes it more clear.
Yes, basically the ID is not changing at the back end, so that's why
right.
Correct. Good. Thank you, Bharat.
No problem. Importing modules, I think I would skip for now. It's I can explain a little later once you're more comfortable with other things. This book is in my GitHub. You can go through all of these. It gives you just operations, minus, plus, division, a floor division, a remainder, modulo division, and all that. This is all about lists. Strings, I've spoken about what are strings, how to slice, dice strings. Okay, strings are immutable. In sense, X is equal to...
Bharat, sorry, Vikas here. Just yeah, one yeah. quick question. This is regarding the discussion that we just had. So is there a way to handle a point by reference in Python? So
no.
As you
Python know. Memory management is something that is internal to Python. It's not exposed to end user. So when you use okay. programming languages which are little more lower level, like C,
yeah.
you can exactly have a pointer point to a memory location. But Python is a little more higher language than C. Higher language in sense, I don't mean to say high in terms of superiority. Low level language is closer you get to the actual hardware. Higher is more abstracted away from the hardware.
Yes.
So
yes.
In Python, memory management and the reference management is all managed internally. So in C, what happens is if you click X is equal to 5, you have created an object which points to 5. Later you change X. You need to manually delete it. in Python, there is something called a garbage collection that happens every couple of microseconds. So in the example which I showed, X pointed earlier to an object, now it points to something else. Every couple of seconds, Python would at the back end, you would not see it, but run something known as garbage collectors. It will collect all the variables in memory which have nothing that points to it, and it will clean all of those. So all of this is abstracted away from end user, and Python manages it internally. You would not have control over assignment of objects and where in memory does these objects lie, and that's what makes it extremely efficient.
Okay, okay. Thanks, thanks Bharat.
No problem. So X, Bharat, X 3 would give me third indexed letter. So B is 0, H, A, R. It gives me R. Let's say if I assign something to it, I want it to be P instead. See, it says string object does not support assignment. So while you can change what X points to, you cannot change some of the objects inherently. So what I'm coming to is, these are the type of objects once you start using it. If you don't want an object to change inherently, this is one of the things. Perhaps you'll store it as a particular type of object. I've just shown an example of it being string, but it need not always be. But I just wanted you to see this, that you cannot change portions of the string. But now let's say you really wanted R to be changed. You want to change the spelling correction. You can always have another variable which you can say, I want Y to be X starting from 0 till the second digit, and I want P instead of R. And again, I want to continue till the end. Now, if I see this, I ended up changing the index incorrectly. So 3 and 4. So this is how I would have replaced it. But inherently, can I change the object directly? No, I can't. I can create a copy of it, store it to Y, and do operations on that. So in here, I've created a new object and asked Y to point to that object. So now if I do some changes to X, like X dot append, convert X into a list and X dot append, it would change just X. It won't have any bearing on Y, because Y is pointing to something which has been created out of X, a different object altogether. Rest of it is fairly same. You can go through it. List I have covered. I have not covered something known as tuple. And how to unpack tuples. List I have covered. Dictionary. Okay. So two topics left for the day. And again, I would continue saying it till the point it becomes irritating, that you need not remember, memorize any of these things. Just be familiar with the basic concepts like object, where does it point to, everything is an object, objects can have some values and things like that. Don't worry about methods and memorizing anything. It will become your second nature. So like this list, there is another way by which we can have a collection of objects. This collection is known as tuple. Tuple, same, let's call X a tuple. Tuple uses smooth brackets instead of square brackets. Now, because I have put smooth brackets instead of square brackets, it has become a tuple. Now, don't worry about memorizing again. When do I use square? And it will come to you naturally. Just allow yourself some time and keep practicing. It will come to you. In starting days, it would all seem confusing and unrelated. Just allow yourself 3 weeks. And I promise within 3 weeks, it should all become your second nature. It's just like learning any new language. So whatever we discussed for list and for strings, like slicing, pointing, changing something, dot append, everything is applicable to tuple as well. It's the same. I've given some notes on tuples, on what are these and how to have some operations. It's all available in here. So you can see this. With list and tuple, you have one additional. I'm sorry, someone was asking something.
No, I was saying when you are saying it is same, then what's the difference? Why we are having the separate thing?
Correct. So tuples offer some unpacking features, like it's the subtle difference is when you start using functions extensively, and especially functions which give you back multiple things, there are particular ways in which you want to handle. Okay, I'll give you a brief example. Let's say this is a tuple. Now you have millions of these, and each of these is million things big. So you have each tuple with millions of objects. And let's say object of your interest are only first two objects. What you do is, let's say A and B. Now you are assigning two things at one go. So first, let's say, how do we assign all of these? A, B, C, D, we have 4 is equal to X. Now if I say A, first value, B, second value, C, D. Now, let's say if I don't know how long this would be. So here I knew 4, so I put 4. Let's say you never knew how long would it be. So think of it being a production line where you just want to pick up first two of the products and discard the rest, let's say. So you can say A, B, comma, star C, or star any, whatever you can put, because you can choose any of the anything as a variable. So X, now A first, B C, whatever was pending has been appended to C. So if I wanted only first object, A has first object, and whatever is left over gets pushed into the second variable. So often you would find these sort of operations necessarily in some type of scenarios. So when you're trying to mimic out of everyone who came out of a gate, you just want first person to be identified and you don't care about the rest. So you'll use these kind of data structures. This is something that is not possible in list. In list, you'll have to slice it. So in list, you will have to do something like, so you can convert a tuple into a list and same way list into a tuple. So I just say list X. In here, I've taken object where X was pointing to, converted that into a list and assigned it back to an X. Now X has become list because you see square brackets. So I would have to do A is equal to X. A is equal to X 0 to 1. This is how I get A. But see, this is when numbers are quite large and you have these things varying, it would be much easier to work with tuples. And also tuples offer some immutability, which I'll show later, which differs from the
Bharat, just one question, sorry. So in this case, like right, the in 137, this A is of type list now? Or would it be a normal int, the 137 in? Yeah.
Let's check. Yes, because you see, it comes with square things.
Yeah. And in the tuple, it would be a int. Okay.
What's happening? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So A it's just an integer. And then finally, there is something called a dictionary. So imagine dictionary is a key value pair. So everything has a key and a value. So easiest way to think about a list is, okay, allow me 1 minute. It would be easier for me if I can draw this out for you. How do I connect this now? Okay, so I can draw it here front. So dictionary is, imagine it as a huge table with lot of values.
We can just say it as a phone dictionary, right? Phone directory. Phone directory. We can give an example like a phone directory, names and the numbers.
Yes, you have names and numbers, but in dictionary, what happens is you have, just like name is a key. Here you would have a key which will help you identify whatever. It might, it need not be a number. This can be a list, it can be a tuple, or it can be any object in general. So you can think of key value pair as a bunch of objects which can be accessed via a key. So as long as you know key, you can access all these objects. Same way you would have multiple keys and multiple objects. So I'll show you in Jupyter notebook. Tuples had round brackets, list had square brackets, dictionary has a curly bracket. So let's say x equal to curly bracket. Okay, let's type it from scratch. Anytime it's a curly bracket, it would mean dictionary. So I've created an empty dictionary just to show you. Type x dictionary. X was a key value pair dictionary. So first I'll have to define key. Let's say key was A. And value was, I wanted to show you some specific example of it, but nevertheless. So key and values are separated by colon. Now this value can be anything. So let's put a list. And then next key is B. And to this key, I want to assign, let's say, just a string. Now this X is a dictionary. How do I access? So, you know, in list, there was a way in which you could access any element, any object of your choice. Same way with tuples, same way with strings. You knew how to. So same way X, square bracket and key value would let you access all the values from that key. So X references A, which is the key to give all the values. So X, and I put a key of B to give all the values stored in B. Got it? So usually all of these, why so many data structures, is each has a different application and each has a different way it is optimized. So the way Facebook is able to pull up so quickly. So imagine you have a huge list of friends and you want to search. So when you open Facebook and you're typing through search that I want my friend Praneeth to appear, I'm typing P-R-A-N-E-E-T-H. If you had 1 million people on Facebook, in a list where X had 1 million objects in it, it will have to traverse through 1 million things, or it has to at least traverse substantially long to arrive at Pranit. Now, a simpler way is you assign objects, everything that starts with A gets assigned with A, everything that starts with B, all the people whose names start with B gets tagged to B, say, so on and so forth. So what Facebook search would do is X name, and then it will quickly go to P and then pull up only the names, and this will be a much, much smaller list. In reality, what happens is instead of just having key value pairs of names, it would have key value everyone with a gender, male or a female, anyone within particular age category, 0 to 10, 10 to 20, 10. So it would create millions of these key value pairs based on different criteria, and as and when you want to find someone using those. And that's why it's so amazingly fast. So dictionaries are often implemented to store a little complicated data structures, but this would be what you would be using very, very often and almost all the time in Python. We have covered
dictionaries. Bharat, sorry, there's a question on the chat window by Mikhail. He's asking, even sets have curly brackets, right?
Yes, sets have curly brackets. Difference between sets and any other thing is, imagine set as a set of independent and unique values. In a list, how do I see chat window? I don't want to miss anyone else's question. Okay. Yes. So sets have this unique property that it has set of unique objects. In everything else, like list and tuple, you can have multiple things. So this can have 1, 1, 1, 1 and everything 1. But a set cannot have that. So set has that property that allows you to store unique objects in it. While set has its own properties, in machine learning or data science, I haven't seen much applications of sets directly. In Python 3.9, the next one, there is a huge amount of upvote on. So Python is a community maintained, it's an open source. That means that no one particular organization or person owns it. It's open to all, and there is a huge collaboration between quite a lot of people who are volunteering to code and make changes. And the beauty of it is people can ask for features, people can upvote it, and then it is decided. So next generation of Python perhaps might get rid of sets for something which is known as a double linked list. So the way it is implemented is very difficult to explain, but for that reason, I've left out sets from this explanation, because purely we won't be using it. I'm not saying it's not useful. It's a very, very useful data structure, but we won't be needing it for machine learning. That's why I've kept it out of it. But to answer to your question is, set is similar series, just like any other group of objects. It's just, it has unique objects. Second, to define a set, you would require curly brackets, just like how we have defined for dictionary. The difference between then dictionary and set is just a group of objects. It does not have this linking of key value pair. So X is equal to 1, 12, 13, 14. This becomes a set. Now, can I do something like X 12, 12? No, because set is a group of unique values. Invalid syntax. It doesn't. So it has allowed me to enter this, and it's also a set. But if I click X, you see, it's still just 12. It's not multiple 12s. So set and dictionary both come with curly brackets. You're right, Mikhail. The difference is dictionary is a set of key value pairs. Set is just a group of objects, group of unique objects. So set can be used when you have applications like you have multiple numbers. let's say x equal to a tuple of 12, 13, 14. I'm typing random numbers. And some of these are duplicates. You want these duplicates to be removed and then used it as an index to refer something. So I can quickly convert it into a set. And then type, you see all the ones have now collapsed into one single object. This was duplicated, it has collapsed onto one object. So this is a quick way of getting rid of duplicates. It's a quick way of getting rid of duplicates and then sorting things. You see, it's a sorted group of unique assigned objects. So it comes sorted. So if I want to quickly sort something, remove of duplicates, sets. But usually we won't use it much. But I hope that answered your question. Okay, thank you. So that covers almost pretty much everything I wanted to cover. Yeah. Oh, I can move this. Dictionary. Yeah, dictionary, two more things. Now, X, let's say again, this dictionary. If I just want what are the keys in X. So same way, I put dot and press tab, it would give me all the methods that I can use. So it says values. Let's see what that is. So you would see it gave me values. What is stored within each key? It gave me values. Same way, X dot tab keys. It would give me keys. So A and B are keys for X. It gives me these. You might say, why are all these? Why do you need to know all this? Is later when you so let's say in Facebook, I wanted to find people who are my close friends' names starting with P. You would first want to know whether there is a friend name starting with P. You'll figure out all the dictionary keys, extract P, and then grab values out of that and iterate over the values to reach where you want. You'll see all of that in next few classes, so don't worry about it too much. But these are some of the objects, methods, and basic things about Python and Jupyter Notebook I wanted to talk to you about. You have these PDFs, ebooks available. One thing you would notice is if you Google these things, there are millions of books available, hundreds of tutorials available. I will not say one is better than other. Everything is good as long as you are following only one and not getting confused. So different people have different way of doing things. Same way, just as language, each one has their own style to speak a language. You will, as you will progress, you will find your own unique way of, your own unique style of coding. So you might find little differences here, there, but syntax mostly remains the same. Pick any book of your choice. I have attached onto the GitHub repository the book I found most useful. So you're free to follow any book, but try to install Anaconda, launch Jupyter Notebooks, get familiar with this entire user interface, get familiar with how do I change words, how do I type in here, how do I execute, how do I open, close, and some basic assignment commands. Can I type, can I print? And in next session, I'll start covering some of the flows and two key concepts, NumPy and Pandas. NumPy is just a series of arrays. These can be multidimensional arrays. Arrays is just another name for the list. Internal implementation is a little different, but that's of no consequence to the end user. So think of them just as lists. And Pandas as a series of NumPys. Think of them as Excel sheets, exactly as how Excel sheet is with a header, columns, and row names. These. So I would be covering those. With that, you would know enough Python to be able to start doing machine learning. And we can then third week onwards start some fun stuff. Now, would you know everything that you need to know about that? No. My job, my intent via these first two sessions was to bring you up to a point where you start understanding and you will keep adding to your knowledge as and when we move around. Okay. So now I think we have around 20 odd minutes for question answers. First question I would want, and sorry to keep you waiting so long on the question, if I remember, was what is the significance of Python? Was that the question?
That's right, Bharat. Yeah, please go ahead. That's also a part of my question.
So please ask the question. I will try to answer it as to my best ability.
Hey, just considering the fact that we all come from a very different background. So one is, what is the agenda of this whole course? What are we trying to achieve here? Second thing, what would be the prerequisites, like, you know, which we would be requiring to cover the entire part of this course?
Oh, okay, sir.
Yeah. So, and just like, where are we trying to target? Like, you know, I mean, what at the end of the completion of this course, what are the key skills like that I would be having in my KT and at what level?
Sure. So first I would recommend is in the web page here, you would have something called intro video. It would have answers to all the questions. So however, I'll briefly summarize. I've taught this course since about a year and a half now. And I am a data analyst myself. I work on quite a lot on pretty big data. And for my organization, I'm trying to put some amount of machine learning on this data to make them in predictive field. I work in a bank, so this is for a banking sector. What I struggled when I was learning it, there was so much of material available on internet, and there is so many places you can learn, that I often ended up taking quite a lot of directions. And in the end, there was no real progress in sense. There was so much everywhere. And I always felt that I don't know anything. So there was no structure to it. So first I wanted to put together a course with a structure. Then I started teaching this with a university. Now, because I've broken my association with that, I don't want to name that university. However, that course was not free. It would have given you a certification, but it was around 3.48 lakhs plus some GST, 18%. What I realized was, ideally all of this is available on internet. There is nothing new that I'm teaching, or there is nothing proprietary. There is no algorithm I'm going to teach which is only my own and I've patented. So all I'm teaching is work done by someone else, software designed by someone else, methods invented by someone else. So I just felt it wrong to charge for it. And that's why I wanted to attempt a free course covering the exact same things with the same material, with the same seriousness. Objectives were to be able to teach it to people who really don't understand coding and Python or statistics or mathematics, because this is an intersection of your ability to code, your ability to understand maths and statistics. I wanted to break it down to an extent where someone without any background of in any of these would be able to understand these, and hope is by the end of this 6 month or 5 month course, depending on the pace, is for all of you to be able to intuitively understand how these algorithms work. Anyone would be able to Google an algorithm, copy paste the code and make it work. But I want from these courses for you to be able to intuitively understand how the algorithm works, what is it doing, and be able to rebuild the algorithm yourself on Python using whatever Python skills you would gain. So end of this course, you should have skill sets like the ability to write some very good algorithms in Python. You should have the ability to understand almost most of the 90% of the existing machine learning algorithms out there which are in use. And finally, be able to use it to automate some of your
stuff.
Did that answer your question?
Yes, Bharat. Thanks. Yes.
Thanks. Naam se bolte
hai na. Anyone else has any questions?
Chipri. Chipri Lal.
Hi, Tarun. Can you go on mute?
Yes, sorry.
Okay, so if anyone has any questions, please, I'm available next 14 minutes, 15, 30, Bharat, I want to conclude.
Bharat, Bharat,
Suresh here.
Yes, sir.
Bharat, during the coding, during the course, what you were saying about, let's say there are three things to print some statements, right? Like we were defining a variable or something, and then we were saying print X or print A or whatever. And there is another method of just writing a variable name and it will print it. Also, while we'll progress, we'll also learn about return. There are return statement. It will also print something. So where to use what and what's the difference between these? If you can throw some light on that.
Right. So return statements is when you want to fetch value from within a function. So we'll get there when we talk about functions. But here, let's say D1 is this. Okay. I'll show you fresh. X was this dictionary. One way to print it is directly put a variable name and print it. It comes like this. Now when you use print, Python inherently understands X is a dictionary and would format the print in a way which will look a little better. So here I can't show you actually because we are not using anything complicated. But when you are using pandas and data frames, you will understand. When things are little, when you just type in variable name, it will come up in its raw format. It would not look very pleasing to an eye. But when you put print, Python knows how to format it. So if it's a table, it will actually put an HTML formatting code to it. It will look like a table. When you're using data frames, it would come up neatly formatted as a table instead of coming garbled when you just type a variable name. So print would just understand what is that you're trying to print. And often a lot of people just call it pretty print because it just makes things pretty. That's the core essence of it. Otherwise, any variable can be accessed just by typing variable name as well.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
Bharat, a question from me. So I think this is an addition to the first question that you answered. So I think Saif had asked this earlier as well. So can you give us or explain us like a case study or just a sample of what you're doing in your current profession, how Python and machine learning is helping you solve a particular problem in the banking or finance industry. What would be, I mean, a real use case? Can you give us an example or any of your experience of how you're using this?
I mean, everything that works has some element of data analytics into it, and machine learning mostly, when we start going into projects a little more deeper, when we start picking up algorithms, I would try to mimic. I cannot share the data from my workplace directly, but I'll pick up enough real life examples. Like what I can do is I can actually take analytics from my own website on how many people attend from which countries, what do they interact with. It captures data like when I click home and I don't do anything, I go back to certain page, it's called a bounce rate, or I'm just stuck here and I don't interact with the page. Everything is captured. One of the case studies would be to take that analytics, analyze, put some learning algorithms to it, and drive up the footfall onto this. So I cannot think of more better way where you can see, you can give your inputs, we can apply that machine learning algorithm right on this website, and you can yourself see how the footfall changes. But to answer your question in a more concrete way, something that I'm currently working on is, so you have these mainframes which are very expensive. Some of our applications are hosted on mainframes, IBM mainframes. It costs anywhere between 13 to 14 million US dollars to use these mainframes every year.
Yes.
So one of the questions was, what is causing so much of stress and why? And it is going up every year. So last year to this year, the growth was around 7 million. We paid extra because of the usage of CPU on that mainframe, the compute which IBM provides. So I was analyzing everything that hits the mainframe and how long does it sustain on the CPU. So how long does a process last on a CPU? It would be every process lasts a couple of microseconds. But I saw some curious patterns that the things which does not lead to any result. Like you trigger a process, it would run 4-5 times before dying, because first time it ran, it was unsuccessful. It was re-triggered. And then you find patterns on what are different type of these processes which are highly likely to fail. So you can analyze things like the duration, average duration taken by a task usually, and compare it to the current duration it is taking. And then say if it exceeds this, it's highly likely to fail. And then given that previous history of that transaction, so if it has not failed in past couple of days, highly likely it will not fail now as well. Plus some other characteristic unique signatures, like where exactly is this process triggered from and what is the size of data it is taking back from mainframe. Combining all of this, you can put some analytics which gives a probability of that process getting failed. Now you can define a threshold that every time something breaches that threshold, don't allow that process to run. And this process goes to another algorithm now, which tries to identify what is it, why is that this causes failure. And then because it's on a neural network, it gives suggestions on what can we do to make this process better. In fact, most of the currency fake detection algorithms all run on machine learning. So when a bank tries to decide, or in fact, 3 years back, I think one of my favorite guys from machine learning, the guy who started this revolution, they won the Fields Medal. Like Nobel Prize is given every year. There is something called a Field Medal, which is given only once in 4 years. And there's something called a Turing's Prize. That is like a Nobel Prize for computers. This year's Turing Prize went to a person called Jan Lekan. We will analyze quite a lot of his algorithms in my program as well. So Jan Lekan was the first person who was able to detect handwritten digits with an accuracy which surpassed humans. That program was bought by United Postal Services and the US government. So the processing power increased extensively. So all these letters would go under a camera and it was able to read the PIN code and direct it to appropriate route accordingly. And this single-handedly led to over 80% increase in the Postal Service Department's efficiency. Just one single thing of having ability to recognize handwritten digits. Now, this works very differently from how OCR are. OCR is still like, it cannot detect based on if you write zero in a very, very different way. OCR is just a pattern, exact pattern shaping device. It cannot do what machine learning can do. So some of the ways that it is used is signature verification, face identification in banking especially. So we use it for quite a lot of things around portfolio management, especially when something has to be recommended on how likely is a portfolio to have strayed away from tracking an index and what should be done about it is what these algorithms do. But we would work quite a lot on these real life examples.
Okay. Just a follow up question. This is a technical question. So as we have Python, we have heard about R as well. R is also a language that is much used now. So what are basically the differences, and can we kind of debug or write programs in R using the same Anaconda setup? Because I saw something of that sort when I was installing it as well.
Right. So what happens in Anaconda is just a program manager. You can create environments and you can trigger. But in the end, Anaconda is running. You're launching this Jupyter notebook from Anaconda. And within Jupyter notebook, I've created a new file with Python kernel in it. Actual Python is something at the back end. Actual Python would just look like this, nothing else.
It's right.
A program. Yeah. These are just interfaces. Same way R is a program, and your usage interface from it would be something like an R Studio. Now, when I started learning, I learned R Studio first and then I moved to Python. I'll tell you reasons why. And it was a very painful decision for me because I was so madly in love with this R Studio and the entire R philosophy of how data is defined and worked by R. Very beautiful, very elegant, extremely strong and friendly community. But having said that, there are certain things which R just can't do. So R is best when exploring something for elementary data analytics or very deep data analytics, very good visualizations, publication quality. Most of the data classes are taught on R. Why my choice of Python was, data analytics is one way, one part of it. But if you are not able to use it in real life, there is no use of it. To be able to do something in production where it would never be that you have a static list of file which you would analyze and then come back with recommendations. You would always have data which is changing, constantly getting updated. So you would need applications which talk, ingest that changing data and change their algorithms dynamically on flow, change their output on flow. This is where R struggles really, and Python is really one of the best tools I've seen to be able to cope up. So you can develop apps, everything right from Python. You can write your own server code from Python. In R, how it is done is you would deploy your algorithm, you would write your algorithm in R, but come back to these kind of tools, Python, Django or something to, for you to be able to deploy it somewhere. So that's the primary difference. But otherwise, if someone says Python is more powerful than R, no. There is technically no difference, just the language is different. Underlying things that what you're trying to do still remains the same. R is, I find it more elegant than Python. Python is a little crude, but Python is, it allows me to do quite a lot more things which R doesn't allow me to do. So, yeah, there is no, R can do everything that Python can do, except for application side of it. Different libraries, both are very strong, both have very well-supported communities. So there is no preference for me when I pick one over the other purely for data analytics. Why I'm teaching this in Python is R has a little higher learning curve, little more steeper. And Python, let's say you don't want to use it for data analytics, you can use it for anything else. It is a skill which you would acquire for rest of your life. R is a primary statistician tool built for statisticians by statisticians. Python is a software built by software engineers for people who code. That's how I would summarize it.
Bharat, a quick question. So we know that the world is moving towards, you know, artificial intelligence and machine learning to, you know, make our life easy, like the day-to-day ops processes that we have. We know that this Python, R, and all other languages are used for data analytics, right? Mostly the data analytics. So these are the analysis that where we are doing the number crunching and all historical charting and everything. But what I'm trying to understand is Python or R or any other machine language can be used to automate any day-to-day operational processes or something. So for example, very, very simple example. For example, I have to send a mail to a client using some Excel file, right? I'm going to my Excel file, I'm finding something, you know, really bad in that, and I'm saying, sending it to the client via Outlook and saying that, okay, this is something that I find is fishy. So is the whole process can also be automated using Python? Because there is no such a number crunching or anything.
Yes, Python is primarily designed for automations only.
Okay.
And one of the byproduct of that power of Python was ability to do a lot of data crunching. So primary reason for Python to exist is to automate most of your work. So things like opening your Outlook, going through all the emails, classifying them according to a category in a folder and responding to select few of them, mm-hmm. and have the ability to attach some particular predetermined file. Is mm-hmm. all possible within Python. And in fact, it's not too difficult. If you Google around for a couple of mm-hmm. hours, you should be able to do it yourself once you're comfortable with the language. Entire body of air, the way air traffic controllers work in USA, the entire air control is built on an application which runs on Python. 90% of healthcare applications, which are both time and accuracy critical, runs on Python. So at the back end, whatever software you might use, which looks very fancy, back end would be Python only.
Okay.
So most of the very complicated websites, applications, mostly are Python at the back end.
Perfect. Thank you, Bharat. That answers my question.
Sure. So in case you have any further questions by anyone, please feel free to email them to me. You can leave comments on the website. On Sunday, that is tomorrow, I would upload this recording as well as set of Jupyter notebooks plus some more material. And I would put a structure to it and I would add a presentation. So what I would suggest is go through the presentation. It would give a stepwise things to do. So step one, read this. Step two, try to do this. Step four, do this. Sort of a list. Follow that through. And then same way, I would upload everything onto the website. If you have any questions, feel free to email your questions to me anytime you want. Okay. So thanks again for your session. If you have any feedback, it would just help me deliver these classes better. Email them to me. No need to hesitate about anything. Happy learning. Tomorrow, check back the website. I would have material. So next week, Bharat, try to practice on that material and I'll see you next week.
Hi, Bharat.
Yeah, Naseem.
Just one question, sorry. I'm going back to the basics which you taught us today. You know, on the slicing, when you started slicing a string character. So while slicing list, it did not consider commas as, you know, as a character. However, when you were slicing string, it was considering even a space as a character. So I actually missed that part. If you just
okay, I will show it to you again. And perhaps in a little easier way, which you can understand. Okay. So string is a series of characters. A, B, C, D, E, space, F, comma, G. If I put enclose these within these quotes, within these quotes, this all becomes one object. This is one object. Within that object, I'm trying to slice. So if I slice from one, this is one, this is zero. Two, three, this is what is written. If I slice from four to six, it's putting a slice here, which includes this space. If I put a slice between these two objects, it includes F and a comma and G because this entire thing is one object. List, however, is a group of objects. So object one, object two, object three, object so on and so forth. The way you are accessing, and these objects are separated by commas. When I'm slicing it through, I'm pulling objects. I'm pulling this object, or these three objects. This comma is not a part of object. This is a way to separate objects. Okay. In here, it's all one big object and comma was a part of object. That's the difference.
Okay.
Does it make it clear?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, nice.
Thank you.
So, yeah, that concludes our session. I'll upload the recordings and material for next week. Anytime you have any question, please email these to me. Happy learning. I'll see you all next week. Thank you so much.
Thanks. Thanks, Bharat. Thanks.
Thanks, Bharat.
Thank you.